大家好，我叫任威，来自
I'm Renwei, coming from Startups Wuhan, so it's really an honor to share with you Zephyr's security design in Zephyr and its implementation in Snow's ARC processor. Today, my lecture is divided into four parts, Zephyr overview and status update, the security and safe design flow, and if you are participating in the keynote speech, you will have more understanding about the Zephyr. So here is only a brief introduction. The second part is about the secure, safe, and design flow. And the third part is about the dynamic and runtime security design. And the fourth part is the Synopsys designware ARC processor support. So for Zephyr, yesterday, Kate has shared with you a lot of features about Zephyr. I'm not repeating him. So here I only want to highlight several different features. Safety, so for the safety, we are adopting a thread isolation method. And we also have the stack protection, quality managed, and there is no build time. There is also the build time configuration, no dynamic memories for the security part. Because in the safety, in Chinese, the safety and security are the same word, but in English, there are two words. So for the security, it's more about the information security in English. So it will support the user space. And also different encrypted bit database, and we also supported the update of the software. And for the third part, let's talk about the different models. In the Kubernetes support and ran as little as 8K RAM. It actually supported 8K config RAM, and it will enable applications code to scale. And it's also cross-platform, which is, can be represented in two different platforms. It has multiple architect support, and it's also supporting the 86 RISC files, and also have the native support. And for the open sources, it has a quite good RPG2 licenses, which is managed by the Linux foundations. And for the middle part, it's about the open source. Zephyr actually followed the Apache 2 license. It is managed by the Linux Foundation. And this is also very important because it's a third-party neutral platform, and it does not belong to every single company. Not until not ARM, it's a Linux Foundation platform, and relatively speaking, it's quite neutral. The another part is about the connectivity. Currently, on the markets, you will see so many different open source platforms, especially for the Bluetooth 5.0 support. Apart from that, it also supported the 8.1245. And for itself, it also supported the multi-station IPUC, IPU4, and IPU6 function. This is a Zephyr structure because we have many different details, so I'm not going to elaborate for a single part of the details. I believe that from the website of Zephyr, you will have more information. So what's new about the Zephyr updates? The first part is about the Zephyr 1.14, released in April. This is a very important release. It means that Zephyr is mature and more easy to be connected with different projects. It do a lot of release updates. Re-implemented autonomous system, a new experimental BLT split software controllers, and in the logging and the shell system, we have also have major updates. We introduced a new REST tool for managing multiple repositories and enhanced support for flashing and debugs. There are also a lot of bug fixes, and you will find the release information on the website. The next time release is going to happen within 3 months. In the year 2018, it's going to happen. So the feature is going to be jumping from 1.19 to the 1.14. So 1.14 is an important milestone. For the next step, we can open up a new chapter. And for the Zephyr 2.0, you will get the new information. But for the ARC sector, this is the occupying the majority of my work. So we are going to tell you about the security show DEE. And we also have several different features, including the ARC server, supporting the SNE, SNP. We are also going to provide more development flows. So here, from the design perspective, how will Zephyr service work? This is a quite simple Zephyr development procedures. On the leftist part, we are starting from the borrow request, and we are also generating an audible product. So in the request procedure, the Zephyr have a quite higher requirements because we need to do many different researches. For example, the code and also the auto changes. And later on, we believe that the CI is going to finish the review procedures. We need to check about the developer's review. If you want to merge a top pull request, there at least there are two developers need to prove that. And you can actually check whether you could meet up the requirements. If you code pull request can be merged with the mainstream line of Zephyr. So what kind of CI will Zephyr do? It will run a task, it will do the quantity checks, it also is going to do several unit testing. After that, Zephyr will be going through the release procedure. There will be a single procedure for Zephyr. It is going to clarify all kinds of the issues. For Zephyr, every time they need to control the issue for a certain time. Especially for the high issue, it's not going to support 5 grams, and for the lower issues, it's not going to be surpassing. So before the release, you will do many different auto release and auto typing to guarantee the release quality. The OTS long-term support means that Zephyr is going to kept for at least a 2-year solution, and based on that solution, it's not going to have a new feature, but it's going to have a more stable buffer. In the IOTS, it's a very important procedure. The final procedure is audible. Audible is a feature for Zephyr. And Zephyr is not only about the product ready, and through a function of that, you can use it for several different parts. For example, you can use the Zephyr for the industrial control, medical service, and the electronic components. Zephyr is also highly automotive. So on the right hand, there's a certification about the best practice. That is to say, all the process procedures of the Zephyr is highly recognized. So I'm going to give you more introduction about the function security. Zephyr is going through a series of function security recognition. We all know that Zephyr is a quite large platform, and Zephyr is not going to cover every single part. It will have a release function scope, focusing on the core part of Zephyr, OS services, POS connection, and also the connecting sector. And we are also going to do other parts and expanded it to other sectors. And from this security protection, we are going to have a long-term protection with the NSU and PTU protections. And for the structure perspective, we are aimed at a higher Zephyr. So our target is that we need to have a 100% covered Zephyr. So the code is going to be achieved through the Mr. C, because Mr. C is a certification in the aerospace. You code must be written according to their requirements to guarantee a safe agenda. In the unification part, Zephyr currently is supporting the PS1 5.2, and for the long term, it will support the PSE 5.4 requirements. For the Audible code base, if you want to use the Audibles for the common GitHub code developing methods, it's not going to be developed by Audible. For every single phrase, you need to have a function security recognition.
And as you can see on the GitHub community, it is hard to make sure that we can pass the security check. So there is a dedicated team doing the certifications. And it has a management process to guarantee that we can pass the security check. And also there are some important files. So in terms of which hardwares and targets to choose to ensure that you will pass the security, well, there is a security working group to determine that. And at the initial stage, it will only face to the subscribers, especially the paid subscribers, but in the future it will be open to the public. So that is the Zephyr design flow about secure and safe design, overall status update. So next, let me share with you about dynamic. So which means that when it's running, what kind of secure design under dynamic scenarios. First, Zephyr supports user space, and it's very interesting. In Windows, actually, you saw this before, and however, in the real-time operator systems, doesn't have many user space. I think Zephyr is probably one of a few support user space open source iOS. In some major iOS in the market, they didn't support user space, but Zephyr support user space. So what is user space? The user thread has a user thread and a kernel thread. User thread is untrusted. It's limited in terms of the access authorities. There are some things that cannot be accessed, but for the kernel threads, you have all access. You can do whatever you want. So what are things in the kernel thread? This is the same with the Windows design in terms of design rationales. It has drivers, network stacks, and they are in the kernel. Threads. A problem user thread is limited, so if there is some leak of information, so it's very dangerous, but all of this will be detected by the Zephyr, so you will find there's a problem with user threads, with kernel. And in terms of the user mode, what kind of thing you need to do on the Zephyr? First of all, it is face to the driver, device driver, control access to kernel objects and device drivers. They are per object and per thread basis. It will control kernel objects, access thread. You design user space. It needs to facilitate not change the current API. No need to change the API in the application when it comes to maintain compatibility with existing Zephyr APIs, which means that whatever in the past can still maintain it now. And the tools are designed to generate wrappers automatically. So you don't have to change, first of all, the API in the application. In terms of the architecture, you need to improve the system cost, improve the privilege. The implement system calls for privilege elevation. The tools are designed to generate system calls automatically. And also there are ARC specific code to enter user mode. And then for a system call, if you want to have a system call, you need to validate system call parameters, including kernel object pointers. And in terms of stacks, drivers do not require changes to individual drivers and stacks. They are in kernel, and the system calls to drivers and stacks are evolving. And of course, this kind of system call is limited. So in Zephyr, we provide kernel service system call for network or other subsystems, system call, we are continue to perfect it. And the key of a user mode is that the manager user mode access to memory through MPU and MMU, which means the read and write access to the own stack memory and application memory, and the read only and execute access to program text and ROM. And in Zephyr design, we not only consider soft but also hardware terms of design. In terms of kernel object, just briefly introduce it to you. Kernel object are binary field, and what kind of thread it will be accessed. This was through scripts or other mechanisms to generate. So each kernel object has a bit field indicating what user threads have access to it. And the kernel thread can access all objects. But for each thread, it has its own access. For one thread, for one kernel thread, can be lowered to user thread and create child user threads with object permission inheritance enabled. The user thread, if created with permission inheritance, gain access to all parent thread permission except parent thread objects, just like our security mechanism in the gateway. For the system call, it's the same with Linux system. The typical OS mechanism for allowing user threads to perform operation can do. The all ARCs API ID and the parameters are marshaled into registers, and a software interrupt and exception is triggered. And Zephyr also provides for some automation to the local for the bottom developers to facilitate their work. It is easy to develop using our Zephyr platform. Personally, the user space in Zephyr, the key is the memory map. The correctness of the memory map dictates the user mode and whether you can make sure the safety and the security in terms of ARC user space. Most of the time I spend is to correct the memory map and the CPU memory. So let's take ARC. This is a flat model. And first, in terms of the root, Zephyr core code, user code, all of this is read and write by the user, but it cannot be changed. And this is about user application memory, and there are different memory domain. And then you can continue to categorize it. The user can control the domain. In terms of kernel, it includes thread stack. For each thread stack, there's a specific groups also, a stack guard. This is a guard for the stack. This is a blank space. So this is also important to prevent spillover. And also for each Zephyr thread, it supports kernel and user space, which means that the stack, there are parts that user can use, and also there are privileged stacks. We will switch to user stack into kernel stack. This is important. Because if we compare memory map, if we have a better understanding about the memory map, then you basically finish half of the work. And let me share with you the trusted execution environment. Previously, we share with you in Zephyr, there's a lot of things in kernel, for example, driver, network stack. But here, in terms of trusted execution environment, which means the bigger they are, the more probability that there will be error exists. And for example, some key data, your fingerprint, your bio, your IP, or you want to protect your bio parameters, then you need to key one, use key one to secure it. And for TEE, the TEE implementation can be different. Some is single CPU with HW separation. This is one way to have code and data separation realized in software, hardware, or combination. Or you can use a physically separated secure CPU to physically separate it to guarantee the security of it, the privacy information, because the access is limited to the CPU. Or the third model is to use secure model as a companion to application processor. For example, the KPN module in the computer is a different individual module. Now, the more commonplace is using a single CPU with hardware separation. And on your left-hand side is a very typical example of TEE implementation with single CPU with hardware separation. You can see that there are different models, just like user model and kernel model. Just here, we are separating the software with hardware. And the Zephyr and TEE support microcontrollers. For example, now we are 4 microcontrollers. And now in the market, according to my knowledge, there are 2 types. First is ARC Secure Shield in the V8M, ARM V8M and V8M, and also Cortex MR 3R50, and also there is an ARM Trust Zone M. In Zephyr, there are already support of ARM, but to realize it, it requires ARM Trusted Firmware. On the right hand side, it's about Zephyr. This is the module for ARM. It's not a normal server. The KFM is in the secure module. And there's a lot of complex module within, for example, secure partition. And for KFM, there's a support manager to manage different elements of secure. So overall speaking, it is complex. For ARM, it supports key one. It will be added after key one release. It's easier, and which means that the function is limited. Lastly, as the Synopsys Design Real Art Professor Support, which is also my work, it is actually a self-promotion. So what is my work on a single OC to realize the function? First of all, it's about the introduction of the SIMS ARC. Most of you don't know about SIMS ARC. This is our processor series. We have ARC EM, which is similar to the microprocessor microcontroller. And then we also have SEM family, which is security processor for LTE and mobile. And also we have HT family for routers or TV box. Also, we have an EV family, which is a heterogeneous multi-core for vision processing, for security, AI, and the blockchain. So in Zephyr, we have already support SEM and the EM, and HS family will be supported in 2.0 version of the Zephyr platform. And in the future, we will support SMP. In terms of the development chip, we have different ARC support. There are 2, ARC EM Starkit, and this is for IPA. And also we have ARC IoT development kit. These are a physical chip based on 55 nanometer technologies. And in the future, in 2.0, we will add more chip support. For example, ARC EM software development kit, and it is can be regarded as the upgrade of the Starkit. And also the ARC HS development kit. This is a 4-core processor to realize SMP support on the Zephyr platform. In terms of the ARC Security Shield, in terms of the hardware, ARC Security Shield is similar to the ARC as T1 and non-trusted. It has its own characteristics. I will not go deep into this. And let's talk about single processors. And previously I shared with you about secure and normal. They are actually the same. And if we cross each other, have 4 coordinates. secure user, normal user, secure kernel, and normal kernel. Among these four different coordinates, they are not interchangeable, which means otherwise it will lead to a lot of problems. There's a lot of limitations, but there's a secure model and normal model, which means that there will be specific code to support you, and also there are some specific MPU. We call it a secure attributor. And there are some new calculators being added, and this is different. Some RS kernel only allowed exception in interrupt handling. And for secure shield,
it's just like the TMF form. It also have a security runtime. So it's just like the security ARM. The function is quite comprehensive. It's like to achieve a hypervisor on top of the containers. So the concept is just like Kubernetes. The containers are actually separated from each other. So for how do we achieve in the ARC-EE? At the very beginning, it is a container, and for the ARC-TF, the element is quite complicated. This is a quite simple ARC separation. We are actually dividing it. There are Zephyr and normal Zephyr and the security Zephyr. Normal Zephyr and security Zephyr is going to be put into here. And for the normal Zephyr, we are going to use several services in the security Zephyr through the security function call. And in our experiment, we also choose several different parts. What is the priorities in the two Zephyr? For the ARC, we designed the priorities for secure. And for the security phrase, the priorities is higher than the normal interruptions. And the normal interrupts priority is higher than the normal threat priority. This guarantees that for the normal part, you cannot rip the security part in integrations. For the real-time practice in the part of Zephyr 2.0, it is fully reusing the Zephyr infrastructure and flow. It will fully use the Zephyr infrastructure, so you have no necessity to do the two things. And you can actually address it within one action. For the certain PR, we have the 9341 PR. And the latest update is being merged into this part. In this 2.0, Zephyr 2.0, it's easier for me to use that. It's easy for us to use that. The final part is call to action. If you have some of the sensitive Zephyr projects, there are so many different materials. And if you want to understand the codes, you can actually check out here. If you want to add it to our daily discussion, you can use the AutoMed, and we also have the WeChat group and TSC group. And if you want to talk to the Zephyr developers, we actually recommend you to use the Slack. The final part is also highly recommended, is to join our weekly online meeting. From Monday to Wednesday to Friday, we have our Zephyr meeting. You will have the information on Zephyr Hide. Every night, starting from 11, there will be 1 hour starting. Zephyr is a globalized procedure. It has the US, EU, and Asia partners. So this is the only time period that every single one can accept that. So that's the reason why. I think it's more easy to be adapted because they actually think about the area developers. And it's actually finished the procedure within 1 hour. That ends our discussion. We are going to do the Q&A offline, okay?
Zoom.
不会，你如果微插box，你直接了，不过现在微插box。